Kia ora, I'm Miriam McCummel. We love the game. We're a rugby nation. But is it seriously hurting us? The game is faster, the players bigger, and so too are the hits. And now scientists are warning head knocks and concussions could lead to long-term catastrophic damage. American football has already paid up $1 billion in compensation, and now former rugby players are taking World Rugby to court in the UK. Tonight, Mark Crysell asks, is New Zealand rugby's greatest test about to kick off?
The All Black experience, as close as you can get to the real thing.
Does this trigger memories coming here?
Definitely. You know, the smell, the silence, the cubicles.
But the real thing has to be earned.
When I got the call up, my parents were super stoked.
Jeff Old wore that famous jersey, All Black, number 817.
Can you remember when you were named as an All Black?
No, I don't know where. I don't know where I was, or who I was with.
A moment many young Kiwis dream of, completely wiped from his memory.
You right, mate?
Yeah, I'm good. Just, it's hard.
Jeff Old played in one of the All Blacks' most famous games.
Old is there, number six.
The flower bomb test against the Springboks in 1981.
You can see the flower bombs are landing very close to the action there.
Do you remember anything of this game?
No.
This is a very famous test.
No, I don't remember.
You don't remember the flower bomb?
No. No.
Rugby, the game Jeff Old put his body on the line for.
Oh, the big policeman!
Has brought him to his knees.
What do you think the game's done to you?
Gave me a lot of pride. Representing New Zealand. Everyone, my family are proud of me. I don't know where I'm going.
Jeff was known as a powerful, hard-driving loose forward in the 1980s. More than 150 first-class games, including 17 for the All Blacks.
How hard did you have to be to play the game when you played?
Well, do it to them before they do it to us.
Plenty of cuts, bruises and broken bones, but also, critically, blows to the head.
I call them zingers or bell rung. It happened a lot of the time, and you just played on. Those injuries are never detected.
He was never treated or stood down for concussions, but just recently he found an old tour diary.
Got a belt in the nut, which means I've got a belt in the head. Saw a few stars, but carried on.
Tuesday, October 28th, 1980. Jeff had just played for the All Blacks against Newport in Wales.
Official function at the King's Head Hotel. Did not attend. I went into one of the rooms and chundered. I lay down for 3 hours and then the bus home. Straight to bed, felt really crook.
Concussion symptoms which these days would have seen him sidelined. But this was 1980. Jeff took part in full contact training the next day.
Training in the afternoon, still not feeling too good.
Rugby remained his life after he stopped playing at 30. Coach of the Netherlands, and in 2001, USA Rugby's technical director.
He was a lot of fun, crazy smart, so kind, and I just fell in love immediately.
In Colorado, Jeff met and married Irene.
After the first day we met, we really haven't been separated.
In sickness and in health. But by his early 50s, Jeff was starting to notice changes.
I've started making mistakes myself. I was forgetting stuff, getting frustrated, anxious.
It got so bad, he quit his job at USA Rugby.
He really started to get confused and started to do things that were a little dangerous physically, and not understanding who he was. It became excruciating. I literally was left with someone that You know, by 11:30 in the morning, forgive me, he was drunk, and then he would sleep the rest of the day.
Why were you drinking?
Trying to self-medicate. I don't know how else to put it. It wasn't doing any good. But at the time, I thought it was the only solution I had.
Around about the same time, a number of former American football players in their 40s and 50s were starting to show signs of serious and spectacular mental decline.
What we're primarily talking about is chronic traumatic encephalopathy, or CTE.
US neuroscientist Chris Nowinski, co-founder of Boston's Brain Bank, the world leader in CTE research.
American football players, rugby players, soccer players, Australian Football League players, all of them were finding this disease that you don't find in normal people.
Chris Nowinski is a living, breathing example, a former college football player for Harvard and professional wrestler who gave it away because of head knocks.
Forgot the match. I had a massive, massive headache that really defined it. Every time I'd even climb stairs, I'd almost pass out. But I didn't tell anyone about it.
This is not good for Chris.
I didn't stop until I developed a sleep disorder that I still have to this day that still scares the heck out of me. I have what's called REM behavior disorder, which means I act out my dreams. I have chased shadows, I've tackled people. The reason I stopped wrestling because I jumped off of a bed through a nightstand acting out a dream that I couldn't be woken up from.
Contact sports athletes can take thousands of hits to the head during their careers. Chris says it's not always the concussions.
Oh dear, Sam.
Repeated subconcussive blows are just as serious.
Something about the trauma, the aggressive way their brain twists, causes tiny injuries to the brain. And those microscopic lesions, after you stop playing, continue to grow. Basically, a protein that's a structural element of the cell goes haywire. This disease, in its end stage, is almost always associated with dementia.
The behavioral changes can be dramatic and, in some cases, dangerous.
There's some of these really hard-to-believe cases in young people that involve violence, homicide, suicide.
Chris examined the brain of high-profile NFL player Aaron Hernandez, who committed suicide while serving time for murder. He was 27 years old.
When we first were offered the brain for research, you know, we thought, boy, this is a really high-profile case. We'll probably only see specks of CT that won't necessarily explain what happened. But then we saw this just grossly damaged brain.
CTE can only be diagnosed by inspecting the brain after death, but there are early warning signs.
You're gonna have problems with cognition. You might have problems with your mood and behavior. You might have problems with anxiety, impulse control. We're sort of figuring that out, but it doesn't look good.
Now 65, Jeff Old's prognosis doesn't look good either, and that's from a range of doctors and specialists in New Zealand and America.
They've all, without exception, said it was probable CTE. Early onset dementia is mentioned in some of his reports, cognitive impairment and post-concussion syndrome.
How does it make you feel, Jeff, when you hear those words?
Well, I don't know where I'm going. I don't like what I'm hearing.
It's quite scary.
This is definitely a public health crisis. I mean, the one thing we have to appreciate, is this something that we're doing to ourselves?
It comes through in there, you can see the connection.
There's no getting around it. Rugby is a contact sport. And since it went professional,
it's all about physics. The brain is a very delicate structure.
The players are bigger.
There's no doubt the physicality and the power and the speed is immense.
And so are the hits.
The way the game's played now, if it continues like it is, I think we'll have a huge problem in the future.
James Cunningham, neuropsychologist.
Seems like I'm busier than ever and I have a longer waiting list. From the top, as fast as you can, all of them, across, go.
This is who you come to for help when you've taken a serious head knock or concussion.
I'd say 80% of people would have headaches. Just about everybody has fatigue. Sleep disturbance, initial insomnia or fragmentation are common. Bright light and noise in high stimulus environments cause difficulty. And then on top of that, they have some sort of mood alteration, which can be anything from a bit of anxiety and depression to pretty extreme levels of mood disorder. I've certainly seen people who have considered suicide or talked about it or experienced various levels of that.
He can't name them, but James's patients include some of this country's most well-known elite athletes.
Some of the players I see now have implored me to come on this program and speak for them. Some of these are All Blacks, have said to me, we want you to talk about the symptoms and raise this issue so that other players don't end up in the position they're in.
They've seen the reports coming out of America about repeated concussions and chronic traumatic encephalopathy, or CTE, and they're worried.
I have a couple of rugby players I've seen who I have some concern for. They may develop severe behavioural disturbance and or cognitive decline consistent with what's seen in CTE.
Were they All Blacks?
One was.
And it's often whānau that are left picking up the pieces.
It's normally the wife or the girlfriend, and she will tell me typically that her husband or partner is more irritable, can be angry, it's a different person to some degree.
You're aware then of CTE?
Yep.
Are you worried that you may have that?
I guess you're always worried, you know, it's like... you always worry about that kind of stuff.
In 2014, All Black prop Ben Afiaki's head smacked into his teammate, Brodie Retallick.
I felt quite sick, and that wasn't a nice feeling.
If you think it's tough to watch, imagine being Olivia Afiaki, Ben's wife.
Definitely got in touch straight away, and nothing was making sense.
I can remember it all now because I've watched the video quite a bit trying to recall what happened.
Ben had taken head knocks before. This one was different.
With Ben's history, I was worried for him.
I felt pretty crook afterwards, foggy, and my amnesia from that one was probably quite a long period of time, which was, I think the longer it is, the worse kind of concussion it is. And there can be
damage to these parts. Within 2 months, he was seeing James Cunningham.
The front of your brain can go forward in the tackle and you might strike a leg or a hip.
What was he like when he got in?
Well, his cognition was poor, as would be expected, and he was slow in processing. He was in a bad way.
Ben had suffered a serious concussion. James told Ben and Olivia there was a real risk of long-term damage.
Alcohol, depression, anxiety, you know, listed all these terrible divorce, ultimately suicide, listed all these terrible things, and we just looked at each other and said, well, that's not Ben. He has his life sorted and, you know, we're going to be fine. This is something he'll overcome.
But Ben and Olivia's relationship would be pushed to the absolute limit.
You ready? Just do your best, OK?
Yep.
He'd have to retire from rugby and needed years of rest and treatment. There's no guarantee of a cure.
I don't think anybody makes a full recovery. You can make a full functional recovery in terms of what you can do, like return to work and exercise. But if you have enough knocks, I don't think anybody gets back to their previous state of functioning.
For the next 5 years, Ben's sleep was bad. Headaches, bright lights and loud sounds, unbearable.
Your mood swings, you know, you're up and down. Yeah, I'd snap faster or not be able to deal with things the same I would if I was, you know, normal.
I'd get annoyed about something. You know, it's something that wasn't even a big deal, but Ben's, he wasn't capable of talking about it with me. So we just completely clashed and I'd be going, come on, like, give me something, and then he wouldn't be able to.
Olivia and Ben were under real pressure.
Oh, we've had some points where we walked away from our relationship.
You walked away? You split?
We didn't officially, but it was obviously those situations where you're just butting heads and I didn't understand where he was at and he didn't understand where I was coming from.
I've heard that sometimes people feel suicidal in that space. Did you ever feel like that?
You don't. A little bit. I guess you feel like you're kind of helpless, so...
You feel useless?
You feel useless, yep. You feel useless.
OK, Ben, so we'll try something else now. What am I not?
It's been 7 years now since Ben's concussion.
Is he still suffering?
He will have symptoms, I think, for the rest of his life.
The main one's probably fatigue. I can still get fogginess and mild headaches, but they're all pretty manageable now.
All Blacks aren't meant to show weakness. Ben Afiaki is brave.
How hard is it to be open and honest about what you're going through?
It's pretty hard. I guess I want younger players or players that are coming through, you know, if they feel a little bit crook and after they play a game or get a head knock, you know, I want them to be confident to tell their doctors.
Come here!
Ben and Olivia have worked hard at their relationship.
I feel like we're nailing it. I understand what he goes through and I know his limitations, and I'm respectful of those, and I think vice versa, so we're both, I think it works.
Being vulnerable opens up to letting people in and helping you a wee bit get through them and I guess give them a small understanding of what you're coping with.
Ben Afiaki's story is not one that's shared very often, but how many more are there out in our communities?
Brain injury and concussions are a silent epidemic that's affecting our families and our communities, and people have a real stigma about talking about it.
How many do you reckon are out there?
I think there's an awful lot.
American football spent years denying head knocks were linked with chronic traumatic encephalopathy, or CTE.
The NFL is saying this is being misdiagnosed, this is ridiculous, there's no evidence.
But Chris Nowinski and the Boston Brain Bank had the evidence.
We diagnosed CTE in 110 of the first 111 NFL players that we'd looked at. We were able to take on the NFL because we had the truth on our side, because we had the evidence on our side.
A lawsuit in 2015 forced the NFL to pay out more than $1 billion in compensation. Rugby's own day in court is coming.
I suspect that rugby has a very significant CT problem.
A group of former players are suing World Rugby, the English and Welsh rugby unions, alleging failure to protect them from the risks caused by concussion.
Frightening, to be honest.
England's 2003 World Cup winner, 42-year-old Steve Thompson, is one of them.
I can't remember any of the games. You know, when that's supposed to have been such a big thing in my life, and then it's just not there.
I don't think there's serious scientists anymore who question the relationship between thousands of head impacts in sports and this disease, chronic traumatic encephalopathy.
But it's still a line call for the people who run the game of rugby in New Zealand.
Does New Zealand rugby accept the link between head knocks and CTE?
It's simply too early, and we need to do more research into this area.
Mark Robinson, New Zealand Rugby's CEO.
You know, there are any number of potential causal impacts on in this area. Lifestyle, genetics, genetic makeup can be a couple that have been identified.
I think they're trying to look after the brand more than the players.
Former All Black Jeff Old believes he's struggling with early onset dementia because of the knocks he took.
The brand of the All Blacks is, you know, very profitable. And pre-professional days, you know, players just seem to be left in the dust. Although we were part of the brand, we established the brand.
I don't accept that. You know, I care deeply about everyone that's played the game. We believe we have a duty of care for anyone involved in the game, and I guess we're doing all we can at present to try and understand the issues as much as possible.
And New Zealand Rugby is spending millions to get its head around head knocks.
We don't have a good understanding around the impacts that happen during a game.
Thanks very much for coming out, guys.
Danielle Salmon is a research scientist for New Zealand Rugby who specialises in concussion.
So, I guess there's a lot of misunderstanding about this, but I'm just going to give you kind of the quick and dirty about what a concussion is.
She's leading a concussion study in conjunction with World Rugby using state-of-the-art mouth guards.
They've got an accelerometer and a gyroscope, so what it does, it kind of gives us an indication of what's happening to the head.
700 Dunedin rugby players, including these Otago boys' high pupils, are wearing them this season.
if they have an impact, and that kind of triggers something over 5 Gs, then that's captured in the mouth guard. And we've got a timestamp where we then can match that to what's happening with the video.
The stakes are high for New Zealand rugby.
Like, who has the actual responsibility? Is it like the ref, coach?
Player numbers are declining, and there's growing concern from parents about what the national game might be doing to their kids.
Only about 20% of the concussions that we see in New Zealand are related to sport.
Despite that, a growing number of players are reporting concussions and having to stand down, including the last three All Black captains.
Everything I've been told and all the research is that if you recover fully, there should be no more chance of getting it.
Almost 3,000 ACC claims for concussion were made by rugby players in 2019. 64% of them were between the ages of 10 and 19.
We're seeing more people report concussions, which I think is, you know, is a good thing, because people are then taking the precautions and getting checked out and getting into a doctor.
Is there anything you could do to make the game completely safe?
Can the game of rugby, as we see it now and maybe in the immediate future, be ever 100% foolproof safe? No, that's unrealistic to suggest that, isn't it?
There's risk in everything that we do, and I think it's really just trying to say, can we do all that we can to ensure that we're minimising the risk involved? Because, you know, risk is just part of life.
No one can accuse New Zealand rugby of turning a blind eye to concussion. It has mandatory stand-downs for concussed players, the newest testing technology, and it's constantly tinkering with the rules to protect the head. But is it enough?
The reality is you have to be worried about this the first year you put a child in contact sports. I mean, we've seen CT in people who've died as young as 17, but we've also seen CT in people who stopped playing sports at 13.
Chris Nowinski says no one under the age of 14 should be playing contact sport.
No child should be getting hit in the head hundreds of times before they're, say, 14, right? Before they've gone through puberty. I hope that we can all agree as a culture that before 14, don't damage a kid's brain when you don't have to.
If contact is not what you want your children to do, there's other alternatives. There's ripper rugby that has no contact. There are options, you know, depending on the level of risk that you're comfortable with.
In 2019, Chris Nowinski came to New Zealand to launch a collaboration with Auckland University's Brain Bank. They put out a call for rugby players to donate their brains after they die.
I recognize how important it'll be when that first All Black is diagnosed with CTE. It will get the attention of everybody in rugby worldwide in one moment, and hopefully will be an opportunity to start preventing more players from going down that same path.
2 years on, there's been no donations, but Jeff Old has told them they can have his.
I'm not a doctor. I shouldn't really go there. No. But yeah, they'll find some stuff in there. Maybe not too much brain matter, but maybe some dead brain matter.
No one really wants to think too hard about what their future holds, especially if, like 42-year-old Chris Nowinski, you have a history of head knocks.
So I think it's more likely than not I have CTE based on the tests we've gone through. I could start having some real issues in my 40s and 50s, and I'm hoping, you know, best case, I'm one of those guys who isn't really affected in a big way until the 60s and 70s. There's a time to worry about that, and there's a time to get to work, and right now it's a time to get to work.
That's what Ben Afiaki's done. He's now scrum coach for the Blues. In the game, he still loves.
I've got a pretty good life at the moment. You know, I've got my family and, you know, the job, and enjoying doing what I'm doing.
Ready?
And he and Olivia have plenty to look forward to.
So, you're about to have another child?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you know what it's going to be?
Little boy, yeah.
Yeah. So,
do you want him to play rugby?
I don't mind if he does or not, but I'd probably rather him play an individual sport like golf or tennis, but that's probably me being selfish, yeah.
It's not easy to talk about what rugby did to him, but Ben says if he's learnt anything, it's that it's okay for All Blacks to be vulnerable.
If I can, you know, make a kid aware starting out of rugby that there's risks and the best thing to do is be honest about them, then that's one person, I guess, better.
Well, Jeff Old and his wife Irene have now settled back in New Zealand. Their dream is to create a retreat in the Bay of Islands for retired rugby players struggling with head knocks.